an energy system, that's all the installations which are needed to provide energy to the consumers. For example, wind turbines or power plants, which are needed to produce electricity, the electricity grid, which brings the electricity from the power plants to the consumers, to the households and industry. But also everything that's needed for heating, for example, the district heating grid or boilers in the houses fired with gas or wood. But also the building insulations, which will make you need less energy. We can also include the mobility sector, because that uses a lot of energy, and especially with the uptake of electric vehicles, there will be more integration between the electricity sector and the mobility sector. And we can also include the demand side, which means the behavior of consumers related to the energy consumption, like for example the decision when to charge an electric vehicle, or the decision to heat your house, for example, only to 19 degrees instead of 22 degrees. So the sum of all this can be called the energy system. What's energy system modeling? Now, an energy system model is basically a set of equations that represents the behavior of the energy system. For example, we take weather data for a whole year, and for every hour we have the wind data and the sunshine data for every location in the area that we are modeling, for example, a country. And then we can calculate a wind turbine or a solar plant at every location, at which hour could it produce how much electricity. And then we have also, as part of the model, the load curve. That's basically the consumption. So we know at which time of the day people typically use more or less energy, like in the morning when they get up they use quite a lot, and then when they come home from work and cook or watch TV, and of course at night they use less because they are sleeping. So there's some experience just with how the consumption of energy is related to the time. And then we can see how the generation of the wind and PV plants matches the load curve, and we can calculate how much storage is needed in the system, and then we can also calculate for all our storage devices how full they are at every hour of the year. So what do we need the energy system modeling for? As you know, because of the climate crisis, we need a very rapid and a very deep transition of the energy system, switching from fossil fuels to renewables. And we want to explore different ways how we could actually achieve this, and the models can give us information on this. They can also inform energy policy. For example, we have politically set goals on the extension of renewable energies, and the models can help us to see how much, how many wind farms and solar plants we need, for example, and for the grid planning, where do we actually need new transmission lines. So questions like these the models can help us to answer. Now, one very common question that the models try to answer is how can we achieve this transformation at the least costs? So they are cost minimization. And basically what they do is they model the time frame from now to 2050, for example, and every time a plant goes out of operation because it's getting old, they check, okay, do I replace it with a wind farm or with solar plants, or maybe don't I have to replace it at all, because I can reduce the energy consumption by better building insulation, for example. And then the model just tries a lot of constellations and finds out which one is the cheapest. What we also often do is we compare different scenarios. For example, we set different constraints, let's say regarding the surface area that can be used for wind farms. We can, for example, explore if we want less wind farms because there's a conflict with people who don't like to live near wind farms, or also with nature protection, with birds. We want instead to have more solar plants, so we can calculate, okay, would that work? What would that mean for the storage capacity we need? What would it mean for the grid extension we need? And how much more would this cost? Now, the results of the models depend on the assumptions and simplifications which we have made. For example, in reality, every building is a bit different. So when we look into building insulation in the model, we have to define certain classes of buildings and hope that it represents the sum of the buildings well. But with these physical things, I think it's not too difficult to make valid assumptions. But what's really difficult, of course, is to estimate the development of the cost. Because if we model until 2050, no one knows how much will a photovoltaics plant cost in 2050, for example. That's really difficult. The results, of course, if we do a cost minimization, depends very heavily on the cost assumptions which we have made. Another question is which scenarios are actually investigated. So one criticism of the current models is that they often don't look very much into the demand side. So they don't look, for example, how much energy could I actually save when I give strong incentives to consumers to use less energy. So we have to look, when we interpret the results of the models, which assumptions have they made and which scenarios have they actually investigated, because they can't tell us anything about scenarios which they didn't consider. So it's probably very unlikely that the future will develop exactly as any energy scenario that we investigate now. And we can actually see that the scenarios that have been calculated a few years back, that all of them really underestimated the rapid uptake of renewable energies. Still, the models can give us information about the behavior of the system, and they can show us, for example, and they do, that a system with 100% renewables is actually possible, and it's also not forbiddingly expensive.
Tell me about your education.
I studied energy and process engineering at the Technical University Berlin.
And you worked on power plants?
I had to do a so-called practicum, so I did that in a plant that burns garbage. Also later I actually worked as an engineer for 3 years doing design of small power plants.
And your current job?
At the moment, I'm a scientific coordinator at ACATECH, the German Academy of Science and Engineering. And I work in a project called Energy Systems of the Future.
Which topics do you look at?
Yeah, we look at energy systems. We work together with energy system modelers. I don't do modeling myself. And we give advice to energy policy. So topics I have looked at is bioenergy, flexibility, that's storage and demand response, for example, for the electricity system. And I looked at resources, metals for the construction of renewable energy plants, and currently looking at central and decentral energy systems. So we basically look at a variety of issues related to the system transition to a climate-friendly energy system.
What do you think of the state of modeling at present?
Yeah, I think it's made a lot of progress in the last few years. So if you look at the models from 5 years back, they were mostly looking only into the electricity system and often had now only a very simplified representation of the electricity grid. And yeah, now they have been in the last few years extended a lot. They include now often the heating sector and mobility sector. That's becoming more important in the future, the so-called sector coupling, because we will use electricity also for electric cars, for heat pumps, so the system becomes more integrated, so it's better to look at the system as a whole. So I think there's a lot of development in the energy system modeling, but it also has to get even better.
Finally, how does the German government utilize energy system models?
Yeah, basically the government agencies give contracts to consultants or research institutes, universities who run their energy system models, and then they get reports, and the staff of the government agencies interprets the results. But the modeling is contracted.